Thank you, Sheikh Yahya. I'm sure I share the audience's sentiment that I probably wanted you to carry on. But to counter the balance from the southern hemisphere, we have Sheikh from the northern hemisphere. And I'm sure Sheikh Nuruddeen Lemu is also no stranger to most of you in the audience. We'll hear the words of wisdom and advice from Sheikh Nuruddeen Lemu.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As Sheikh Yahya Ibrahim was coming to the end, you know, you start feeling, oh no, you know, I'm gonna have to talk. I was really enjoying it, but that's life, right? And I think I should remind the chairman that Australia is south, so we will go from the south. We'll leave Canada and Egypt out.
Leave Canada!
Alhamdulillah. It's a great pleasure to be with you, and inshallah, within the time available, particularly since we have time for discussions, we'll leave some of the details probably to that. I'd like to start by just reminding us of what we all already know. And a lot of what I'm going to say, I hope, would just help us remember the points that Sheikh Yahya mentioned, because I think it summarizes a lot, the details of which really a word is enough for the wise. And just contemplate on any of the main points he made, I think you've got enough to go with. Life is a journey. We say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. To Allah we belong, and to Him we return. We are on the return journey. Every day is just another day on that journey back to whom we belong. Death is just a change of address. That's it. For better or for worse. And our struggle is to make sure it's a change of address for the better. And whatever we do in this life, we should never forget that at the end of it all, no one leaves planet Earth alive. I like the way Timon in
"We're Gonna Die."
So we all eventually leave, whether you like it or not, whether you believe in God or not, you better believe you'll die. It's good for you to believe. Death is life's cleaning process. Out with the old, in with the new. When you finish fulfilling your purpose, you go on account. And another generation comes to fulfill their purpose. And we pray we stay on the straight path. We've got a lot of travelers on that path. And we pray we continue together on that path. We have a saying back at home. It sounds as if it came from one of the nomadic tribes. They say, to travel far, go with others. To travel fast, go alone. To travel far, go with others. To travel fast, go alone. And I'd like to tie that to the point Brother Yahya mentioned about the kind of people you go with. Travel far in which direction? There was a land that had a king who was getting old. He didn't have a son to succeed him. And he told his people he has a new idea regarding who's to succeed him. And he said, when I die, whoever is to be king should be king for only 5 years. After that, you take that person on a boat. There's an island not too far away where all the dangerous animals have been put. The lions and tigers and bears, you never find them together, but they're all there. Wizard of Oz doesn't know his geography. Anyway, and the king said, whoever is to be king, king for 5 years, and on the first day of year number 6, you take him, drop him on the island, and let whoever's going to gobble him up. The king dies, and it's announced, this is the new succession system. Who wants to be king? One guy says, me. Okay? And they make him king. He says, yes, I'm going to enjoy myself. So it was partying from day one. Build extension, another party, another dinner. And that's how year 1, 2, 3 came and passed. Marry again, divorce, marry again. And to him, that was just a good life, you know. Spend money, do everything you can. 5 years passed. Said, okay, time to go to the island. Oh, no, please, please. Sorry, too late. Took him by boat, dropped him on the island. As they rowed away, they just heard some roars, a little screaming, and then silence. All right, we need another king. The guy says, me. They make him the king. He says, yes, I've had a terrible life. This is my opportunity to enjoy whatever little life remains. He did more partying than the first king. 5 years later, put him on the boat, take him to the island. What do you say? Not happily ever after. Like the opposite of that, anyway. Then this other young guy says he wants to be king. People look at him, ah, come on, don't be like them. No, I want to be king. Nah, 5 years, you've got a bright life ahead, you can manage, I still want to be king. Okay, so he was made king. Year number one, he got all the hunters to go and gather all those wild animals. Those who are not too wild, put them in a zoo. Second year, he got farmers to get onto the island. Clear the place, beautiful farming. Third year, build schools, get more people to live on the island. Fourth year, made it a wonderful place, beautiful resort. Even built a house there. Year number 5, he built a bridge between the mainland and the island. So he wakes up after 5 years and they say, hey, Your Majesty, time to go to the island. He said, you're most welcome. You know, like, you can even have tea at my place. He thought of the future. We all live here. We'll move to an island when we pass away. And we can do what we can while we're alive to make that future better. Or we can forget about it and live the way you'd just like to live, and you meet what's in place or what's waiting. And really our main struggle in this life, as brother said, was to stay on that path. One of the important things, you know, you'd sometimes ask, why does the Prophet teach us dua? Why does Allah teach us dua? Why not just leave us when, I mean, I know what I want, right? Now, why not just leave us to ask Allah what we want? But what we find is, in dua, Allah places our priorities in life. Dua have ayahs, they have lessons for us regarding what Allah feels is most important for us. And there's nothing more important than to pray ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. I mean, what else do you want? It's so important that if all you do is the 5 daily prayers, no additional nafila, that's a dua you do 17 times every day. That's how important it is. That's how important it should be to us. There's a lot to do in this world. But we don't have enough time. We don't even know how much time we have. And you don't have enough time to do everything. But you do have enough time to do the most important things. You do have enough time to do what Allah is going to ask you about, which is just, did you do your best? That's all. You're not competing with anybody. You're just competing with yourself. Is your today better than yesterday? The Prophet ﷺ says, whoever's 2 days are the same is a loser. Make sure that tomorrow is not another yesterday. It's better. You're better. You do better. Be better. Be more useful. The Prophet ﷺ said, the best among you are those who are most useful to others. We'd like to manage the time we have. Unfortunately, there's not much you can do about managing the time. It's 24 hours a day. It's 7 days a week, and there's nothing more you can add. There's nothing less you can remove. You have the same number of hours as Hitler had. Every day you have the same number of hours as any good person has. Shaitan just has the same amount of time. And so the question is, if we have a fixed amount of time and an endless things of list of things to do, then we just have to prioritize. We can't do everything. So we have to decide, what are we going to spend our time doing? Because you've got an opportunity cost factor there. If you spend 1 hour doing something useful, that's 1 hour away from doing something useless. If you spend 1 hour doing something useless, that's 1 hour away from doing something useful. So what can we do to make the best use of the unknown amount of time we have? But to use it in such a way that you can stand before Allah and say, with Allah's rahmah, you are able to do the best you can. And you pray He forgives you for what you are not able to do. It is important for us to first distinguish two things. Those things we are responsible for, those things we can change, and those things we can only talk about, we cannot change. And to not spend time on things we are concerned about, but which we can't change, at the expense of things we can change with our hands, we can change with our tongues. We don't wait for a time in the future where we are made leaders. Allah has already nominated us as Khulafa, as Vicegerent, as Khalifa. The Prophet made it clear, every one of you is a shepherd and is responsible for their flock. There's an interesting book called Leadership Without a Title. We're all leaders. We shouldn't wait for titles. A responsibility has already been put upon us to do the best we can with what we've been given within the time available. And the things we're expected to do as Muslims are generally classified into two. They're called Fardu Ain, which refers to individual responsibilities that Allah considers obligations on us as individuals, and Fardu Kifaya, collective responsibilities. A Fardu Kifaya, Fardu Ain, your prayers, your own individual, those things nobody expects anybody else to do. You should take care of your family. You should pray. It's not something anybody else is expected to do on your behalf. You pay your zakat, you fast your Ramadan, you do your own. You purify your own heart. It's your responsibility. The Fardu Kifaya are those responsibilities that are fard, they are obligations on a group of people to fulfill obligations which, if they are not fulfilled, society falls into darura. Society falls into crisis. These are fardu kifaya. People who clean garbage, people who clean the sewers, if they stopped working for just 1 month, would anybody die? Just think about it. Would anybody die? You need to visit countries where they don't get sewers cleaned regularly and see how many people die from typhoid and cholera. You get epidemics. So long as those people are doing their job, lives are saved. That job becomes a fardu kifaya. Would anybody die if those responsible for providing electricity decided to stop working for a month or a week? Would anybody die if no electricity for 1 week? Yes, you have to work in hospitals or pharmaceutical industries to know what happens when there's no light. Or ATM machines. And the banks can't give you your money. If your job is in making sure that at the end people don't die, if people who are doing business in transportation stopped working for 1 month, would anybody die? Yes, drugs won't be moved, food won't be moved. Sick people won't be moved. Those selling petrol. So all you have to ask yourself is, does your profession contribute towards ensuring everybody else can carry on minding their own business, doing their own jobs? If we didn't have teachers or no good teachers, would anybody die in 1 month? Maybe not in 1 month. Maybe not in 1 year. But what happens is, when you look at the quality of students graduating from faculties of medicine, faculties of civil engineering, and years down the line, bridges start to collapse. Wrong diagnosis seems to be on the rise. And it coincides with when the group that graduated from that class where the teachers started doing a lousy job. At the end of it, teaching is a fardu kifaya. Do not look at your professional job as some dunya thing. If you know that at the end of it, lives are being saved, jobs are being created. Prophet ﷺ said that the honest merchant, the honest businessman, would wake up on the day of judgment side by side with the shuhada, those who died in jihad. Abdullah bin Umar said, the son of Umar bin Khattab, next to dying in battle defending the ummah, I wish I died doing business. Why? Business allows you to create jobs, to pay zakat, to allow people a healthy, dignified lifestyle, to take people out of poverty. Don't look at your job as some side issue that has little to do with your religion. It's a fardu kifaya. It's a religious obligation, and you should do it with itqan. Do it with excellence. Do it with ihsan. Don't look down upon it. Be the best doctor you can be. You think of people who say, oh, I envy you, I wish I could be involved in da'wah and this talks and whatever. And you look at the person talking, he's a doctor. Allah says in the Quran, to save the life of one innocent person is like saving the life of humanity. That's your job? Every day? Saving lives? And you want to come and do what? And who dies? You're in the best job you could think of. And if Allah has put in your heart a passion for it, I mean, what could be a simpler way to paradise? That you love what you're doing, it's a way to paradise, and it makes you happier. Fi dunya hasanatan. And then inshallah wa fil akhirati hasanatan. It's to look carefully at the job you are doing, the career you have chosen for yourself. How can you be more valuable to people? Remember, the best among you are those who are most useful to others, the Prophet ﷺ said. And once you've decided on your own Qibla, not just for prayer, what you'd like to put your energy into, what is it that's a gift that Allah has given you that is useful to others, that you're passionate about and you enjoy? How can you add value to yourself and be better at doing it and be more useful in the process? It becomes important for us to try and learn to focus. You know, when you get a magnifying glass on a very hot day, get some very dry paper. You could even sprinkle a little petrol on the paper. Put the magnifying glass on the paper, but keep moving it. Would anything burn? No. But when you keep your hand still, when you can allow focus to take place, when light can hit a point, not just everywhere, it'll alight. You start a fire. It's important you really ask yourself, if you're going to have an impact, let alone have a sadaqatun jariyah, something good that continues to bring benefit even after you pass away, you'd have to learn to focus. To have a very clear understanding of who you are and what you want to do, and really, what are you all about? There was a man who was passing by a forest, and he saw this gentleman trying to cut down a tree. He was just sawing the tree. It looked as if the guy wasn't making much progress. Hi, and he left. Hours later, he was coming back, and he saw the same man. Really? And he wasn't making progress, but he was sweating. And he asked the guy, what's the problem? I'm trying to cut down this tree, but you know, it's not falling. Why? He said, the saw is blunt, it's not sharp. So why don't you sharpen it? He said, can't you see I'm in a hurry? Each one of us is like a saw, but you need time to sharpen your saw. Intellectually, you need to find time to sharpen your intellectual soul, to learn, to read. Time for exercise. Your body has a right over you. Time to rest. Time to improve your relationship with Allah. That builds a better spiritual immune system. Bad ideas, thoughts, don't become actions. You tackle them the way the immune system does it. Your relationships, family, friends, and your responsibilities to society, your fardu kifaya. We need to sharpen all saws if we are to remain balanced in our lives. One way of knowing things are going off balance is negative feedback. When you start having arguments with your boss, there's imbalance starting. Or with your wife, or your husband. It's feedback. Something's not balanced. And it's therefore useful to have that feedback. There's an interesting survey of marriages. They studied marriages for a period of 3 years. They were looking at about 400 marriages, newlyweds. Over a period of 3 years, those marriages that in the first year had the least amount of conflict had the highest divorce rates in the third year. Sounded counterintuitive. You know, it should be the other way around. And those marriages that had the highest frequency, actually they said the number of times and the frequency of conflict in marriage has no correlation with divorce rates. What they found actually was conflict, disagreement, was an opportunity for each person to be better known by the others. You're more authentic. They knew the real you, not the acting cool you. The real you. The person felt more authentic. You could be yourself in the presence of this person. And if you didn't like something, you could say it. Maybe a quarrel, maybe an argument, but you understand each other better. Instead of just putting things under the carpet, they're still there, they don't go away. And by the time they're too much, they become too hot to handle, too cold to hold. MC Hammer. You know of the students who put a frog inside some hot water and the frog jumped out immediately. But they put a frog inside a bowl of cool water and it didn't jump out. And they took the frog with the cool water and put that on the fire. And the water was just getting warmer and warmer. But because the temperature was changing gradually, the frog didn't jump out, you know. Guess it was enjoying the warm bath. Frog soup. The frog died in the water. Most of the problems we have, most imbalances, usually take place gradually. It's a step at a time. You know, your expenditure is more than your income. You just have a leaking bucket where the water going in is less than the water going out. And be as patient as you want, you're going to have an empty bucket soon. In every aspect of our lives, we need to have goals for every role. As he said, you're a father to someone, you're a mother to someone, you're a brother, you're an uncle, you're a boss, you're an employee, you're a colleague, you're a friend. You have many roles. It's useful to ask yourself, if I were to leave this world, what would I like to achieve in each role? Yeah. What would I, if I were to pass away before my mother passes away, what would I like her to remember me most for? You pray it's the other way around. But really you ask yourself, for every role, for every person Allah put you in touch with, Muslims or non-Muslims, what do you think you would have to answer? And what is your answer? As Umar radiallahu anhu advised, you know, assess yourself before Allah assesses you. We should be cognizant of our surroundings, of our environment. There was a patient who would come to a doctor. What's your problem? After diagnosis everything, it's malaria. So he's given medicine for malaria. He goes away. 2 weeks later, he comes back. What now? Diarrhea. Give him medicine. Goes away. Comes back. What now? Dengue fever. Allah. Okay, you give him medicine, he goes back. 2 weeks later, he's come with another problem. As a doctor, would you continue treating this person or let the guy die? This doctor decides, let me go and see where you live. and he follows the guy. He crosses some dump sites, garbage sites. Finally, he gets into this swamp. The guy lives with neighbors called mosquitoes. Well, no wonder he'll be coming to the hospital every time. Finds out, where do you live? Oh, this is my little house. How many people live here? Small room, 5 of us. There's no ventilation. Where do you cook? In the corner. See rats and cockroaches moving around. Where do you drink your water from? The well. And what's that other hole beside the well? Or our pit latrine? Put the healthiest person in the world in that situation, he will come to see the doctor every week. We're not just products of our own inner strengths. Most of us are products of who we surround ourselves with. Our precious circle of friends. They influence us in ways we usually are not aware of. And if you find yourself unable to become a better person, ask yourself, are you living in a swamp? Are you surrounded? Do you have your precious ring of friends? You remember Gollum? Yeah, his precious. Have you got a precious ring that's killing you? Think about it. The concept of hijra is to move away from bad company to better company. The jihad to be better, do better, be a better human being, be a happier human being. Through Allah's guidance and the guidance of the Prophet ﷺ is a jihad that never stops. It's like riding a bicycle. You fall when you stop pedaling. But falling is not a mistake. It can be an excellent mistake if you can learn from it and learn not to fall. We all fall. Refusing to stand up again and try again, that's the real fall. Whatever mistakes we do, whatever mistakes we make, however often we keep falling, we should always remember that tawbah, seeking forgiveness in Allah and Allah's rahmah, is greater than anything else. There is no sin in this world that can match the rahmah of Allah. You always try again and again and again. As Allah says, لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Never despair of Allah's mercy. I'd like to conclude with a saying of Imam Al-Ghazali, which is related to the importance of scheduling our priorities, not just prioritizing our schedules. If there's something good you want to do, give it a time. Don't wait for time. Find the time, fix it. Every Saturday morning is when you call relatives. Every this day is when you do that. Anything that's really important, get a time, respect that time the way you respect the time for Salat. Imam Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali said in his Ihya Ulumuddin that you should structure your time, arrange your regular devotions, and assign each function a set period of time during which it is given first priority, but which it does not overstep into the time for something else. For if you abandon yourself to neglect and purposelessness, as cattle do, and just do anything that may occur to you or come to your mind, most of your time will be wasted. Your time is your life, and your life is your capital. It is the basis of your transaction with Allah, and the means to attain everlasting felicity and happiness in the proximity of Allah the Exalted. Each of your breaths is a priceless jewel, and when it passes away, it never returns. Each of your breaths is a priceless jewel, and when it passes away, it never returns. I'll stop there, and as Brother Ibrahim said, I pray that the reward of whatever we have shared also goes to our brother Adnan, who was one of the instrumental people, along with his colleagues, in bringing us to Malaysia again and again and again. I thank you for your patience. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.